Go ahead and get us started since we are recording, if that's correct, Ms. Jen.
Correct.
All right. So the purpose of this roundtable allows the state board members to learn about a topic and ask questions and discuss and invite guest speakers in a less formal setting than a working session, which we usually have on the first Wednesday of each month, or a public meeting, which we have on the third Wednesday of each month. Tonight's roundtable is a learning opportunity for the state board members to help inform how we should look at the role of artificial intelligence in public education. We know this is a fast-growing entity, so we want to make sure we're out in front and we're doing the right things by artificial intelligence. Our partners at the Office of the State Superintendent of Education are leading the creation of a comprehensive and collaborative plan to guide DC in this area. We look forward to working with them and as this work progresses. A brief overview. The State Level and System Policy Committee, which I'm co-chair with Representative Williams from Ward 1, aims to educate the DC community, gather feedback, and provide policy recommendations on issues that require district-wide solutions in collaboration with other government agencies, the council, and the mayor's office. The committee's works help strengthen community voice by organizing public engagement events, drafting resolutions, hosting expert panels, and publishing research reports and more. I will now turn the rest of our committee meeting over to our moderator for tonight's roundtable, which is my friend, Ward 6 Representative, Representative Brandon Best.
Thank you, Dr. Patterson. We are at a very interesting time in education. AI and emerging technology is not only changing how we teach, but many experts believe it will fundamentally change what we teach as well. I personally believe it's one of the biggest challenges that we face in education that not too many people are talking about. McKinsey Global estimates that between 400 and 800 million jobs worldwide will be automated by 2030, while Goldman Sachs believes that 18% of jobs will be computerized. So while there will inevitably be lost jobs that are lost to the AI boom, the jobs that will be kept or created will likely have some form of interaction with artificial intelligence. And those who thrive will have to understand how to utilize this form of technology. The DC State Board of Education, in partnership with OSSE, we're interested in getting in front of this, whether that means developing academic standards or training teachers to drive teaching practices or develop ethical guidelines. We know that this is something that we can't ignore. And the technology is here, it's been here, and it's rapidly changing. So today we have four incredible guest speakers who will join me in this conversation. We have Zia Hassan, a consultant with Microsoft Learning. We have Mr. Lee James, a STEM teacher at Eastern High School. We have Valerie Knight, the CEO of WMW Consulting Group. And we have Mickey Dent, the CEO of Dent Education. So first I wanna say thank you all for joining us. But before we get started, I wanna ask each of you, why is the topic of artificial intelligence important to you?
I'll go first. Just look, there's only female on the bunch. I think it's important to me because I feel like from a educational perspective, right, that this is a tool. AI has been around before I was even born, and I was born in the 60s. So you got to think artificial intelligence has been something that I feel like it's important because it gives us a footprint of where the world is going. From a technological standpoint, as I've shared with you and I've shared with most of the people on the panel, that I feel like we have been so far behind the eight ball. And now to be in the front of what artificial intelligence is, I think it's not only important from an educational standpoint, it's also a learning tool. It's also an important gift that we can teach our educators in order to give our children a better edge on, not only from an educational standpoint, from a technological standpoint as well.
I love that.
Like I jumped in. Y'all
got to
jump in too.
Like, I know. Yeah, it's like we're in a panel.
Look alive. Jump in there with
you tonight. Look, I'm like, look. I opened it up. I need everybody else to jump in as well.
I'm happy. Happy to jump in here next. So Mickey Wolf, CEO of Education. We run a youth innovation hub in Baltimore City, running kind of earn to learn internship programs for Baltimore City students to become the entrepreneurs, innovators, and engineers of the future while being in paid internship experiences today. And for us, I think why we've really seen AI as such an important part of the future of education is because societal shifts like this only tend to grow in their level of embeddedness. You think about the history of the internet where, you know, at first, you know, we, you know, kind of started, it was, you know, very much like plug and play, you know, plug in to connect and, you know, the, you know, dot-com bubble burst, people thought, oh, internet will never be involved. It only got stronger and stronger. And now so much of our life, you know, lives there. Same with developments such as the, you know, kind of mobile phone, which I'm sure for any educators and teachers in the space, you know, we all are experiencing how both beneficial, but also disruptive the mobile phone can be in our smartphone, especially can be in our students' lives. So when we look at AI, I think it's one, probably the most impactful generational shifting technology that's come out in the 21st century that's developed, as you know, Valerie said, has been going on for a long time. I think now we're just seeing it, you know, really hit mainstream impact. And so with a technology that both has an opportunity to generate so much kind of wealth and opportunity and knowledge, from an equity lens, we don't want our students to fall behind. We want our students to be able to learn these tools today, you know, learn these tools to apply them to their own business, see that they can be capable of actually implementing them, and that it's not like you have to be a super advanced technologist to be able to use them, and then be able to leverage those tools as they continue to shape society into the future. So just, you know, I guess to recap, I'd say it's important from an equity lens that our students learn this technology today, as opposed to getting left behind tomorrow.
And Mickey, I wanted to kind of piggyback off stuff that you said, that if we, and I had this conversation yesterday, as a matter of fact, that we are already behind. You know, if you think about from other countries in terms of the technological footprint, our students are already 10 plus years behind. And that when I look at going back to when I started with Tandy computers and the first IBM compatible came out under the Tandy umbrella, that look at where technology went from there and then look at where we are. But we in the States, we're already 10 years behind. Technology is like when we think, hey, something new just came out. The reality is it didn't just come out. Like they've already had benchmarks and they've had, you know, proof of concept. So if we think about from, to your point, like, you know, being behind, we're already 10 plus years behind and our children are affected in the same, at the same velocity because that 10 plus years for them is 15 years. So when we think about kids getting out of high school, the things that they should have learned in the fifth grade, they now are just learning in the 12th grade.
Mickey had my attention at, cell phones disrupting my classroom, but no, my name is Lee James. I teach at Eastern Senior High School, but I teach in the IB program as a theory of knowledge teacher, but then also teach in our IT Academy, where I spend a good bulk of my day thinking about kids' futures. Like, are they going to end up in college? What's that going to look like? Or where is that student going to work out of high school if they graduate with like an A+ certification from our IT Academy? So that being said, like, ChatGPT is this, or just AI in general, AI language models are of huge interest to me because it is rapidly changing the way that college looks or the way that those jobs look. So I have a friend in kind of the college higher ed space, and he gave me some stats about how like 89% of students are self-reporting that they're using ChatGPT, or that 67% of those higher ed you know, employees are using ChatGPT in their coursework. And it, just from like anecdotal evidence, talking to my students who have no formal exposure to it, they all know what it is or know about it. So it's rapidly changing like the world that they are about to go into, whether that's employment, or whatever it is. And so, I think this sort of discussion is extremely important because it's not going away. As Mickey talked about, in terms of disruptive technologies and adoption rates alone, if you look at the history of technological innovation, we're all on this call because we think this is important. But if there's anybody out there that's like, this is a fad, let's wait and see, like the telephone, 75 years to 100 million users in terms of adoption rates. The internet, 8 years. Facebook took 5 years to get to 100 million users. ChatGPT, it took 2 months. It's not going anywhere. Like, this is the most rapid acceleration in terms of like adoption rates that tech has seen. We'll talk about this more, you know, throughout the discussion, but we just went to Microsoft and all of the vendors that we use for our everyday lives, whether it's Google or Microsoft or Adobe, all have AI language models that are being fully integrated into the things we do every day. So it's important to me because I'm trying to figure out what we're going to do, as Valerie and Mickey kind of said, like from an equity perspective, how do we prep our kids for the future that is coming? And I think discussions like this and then acting quickly to give them exposure to what AI models are, what responsible use looks like, is hugely important, but it will not happen on its own unless we're very intentional with our actions and then work with, you know, the educators that have to like boots on the ground, you know, give kids the proper exposure to this kind of technology.
All right. Good evening, everybody. My name is Zia Hassan, and I am education faculty at, I'm faculty at three different colleges in the DC area. I teach a combination of education, psychology, coaching, and business. So I'm all over the place. I also train new teachers, and I coach new teachers through Montgomery College's ACEP program, formerly with Microsoft Education as a consultant. So I've been all over the great state of Maryland and all the institutions here, formerly before that with DCPS and DC Public Charter Schools, and before that with IBM as a technology consultant. Everything has changed, and you can hear in everybody's statement the impact that it's had. A lot of us realize it, and a lot of us out there do not really understand what's about to happen and what's already started to happen. So I, as I mentioned, work with teachers. They are near and dear to my heart. I am a teacher myself. And the cool thing about teaching college is I get to be experimental. I get to break things. I get to try things that may not work. And that's where my passion really lies. I got an exam from a student last semester. I have 7 essay questions on my final exam. It's open book, open note, open internet. And I've always said, you can't Google these answers. You have to apply what you know. Well, turns out that has changed. I received a ChatGPT exam, and I went to my supervisor and said, what do I do? And she was like, honestly, I would turn to you to ask this question. And since then, I've been keynoting and speaking at different colleges. I've spoken now at Georgetown, Frederick Community College. I'll be keynoting at Montgomery College in the spring to talk about my ideas. But just to summarize why I believe it's important to answer this question, I've been experimenting with so many things. I've been experimenting with the fact that we motivate students with grades. May not sound related to AI, but so many students are chasing the almighty A. And so I've been really focused on, if you are going to use ChatGPT to complete your work, complete your schoolwork, it usually the primary motivator would be to get an A. And we've been trying to shift in education away from these external motivators into, how do I get motivated to actually learn, to actually be interested in what's in front of me? This is the time where, just because this technology is disruptive, we can also be disruptive too in education. So I've been experimenting in my classes with taking the attention off of things like the A. And another thing that I've been interested in when it comes to AI is the fact that when I ask my students, what do other professors at these institutions tell you? They say it's, the other professors say it's plagiarism, don't use it, just shove it in a closet, basically. I take it out and actually have my students use it in ways that in prior semesters would maybe even come off as cheating. But I realize now that the human-to-human connection that we have in our classrooms is the thing that we need to leverage. We need to be more human than we've ever been before so that we can work with these computer, these large language models, these generative AIs in ways that are healthy and productive, rather than just using them as a tool to write essays for us or whatever it might be. So I teach my students to coach each other and to use that as a learning technology. I'm an expert in coaching. I teach coaching. I'm an ICF certified coach. So I teach those skills to my students. How do you probe? How do you get deeper? These are conversations they have never, ever had before. And so I'm so interested in technology. I use it myself. A lot of others have covered how powerful and how impactful this is going to be in the future. What I'm most interested in is how can I disrupt what's currently happening in the classroom and run experiments to see what's going to happen and how students will react if I move away from certain ways of assessing them. And if I encourage conversations such as coaching conversations that they've never had before with AI as that catalyst and actually teach them skills that make them more marketable, because these are people that are going to go to schools and be looked at by principals. And if you can speed up your workflow, if you can be more efficient with your lesson planning, if you understand and your professors have taught you and trained you how to use AI productively, well, you're much more valuable. Because now, in this age when we have a teacher shortage and retention is a huge issue, these are tools that are going to alleviate a lot of that stress for many, many teachers. And so I've been exploring a lot of these ideas and will continue to do so in this conversation.
I'm so excited about this conversation, you all. And just to piggyback off of what you were sharing, whenever I have this conversation with people, I often talk about like the calculator. You know, and say, you know, so it's very similar, you know, when we don't teach our kids in the first grade how to use a calculator, right? You still learn the basic concepts. As they get older, they have different kinds of calculators. And when I was, I'm going to age myself. So when I was in school, we were using the TI 81. And during that time, you know, you could have that calculator, but if you didn't know how to actually use it, you would still get the wrong answers. And so that's something that was always interesting to me as well. Earlier, I mentioned that upwards of 800,000 jobs are going to be eliminated to autonomous systems worldwide by 2030. So to put this in perspective, by the time our 11th graders will graduate from college, many of the jobs that are available now will either be gone or will look drastically different. So if our goal is to prepare students for the future, we have to begin to re-envision what that looks like in practice. So my question is, what role do you believe that artificial intelligence and a lot of these emerging technologies should really play in education? And what are the potential benefits and drawbacks?
I think, we talk about equity and inclusion, right? So that's one of the key things that we need to look at. Like, okay, if I live in Georgetown, right? So there's certain things that are accessible to me that if I lived in certain parts of Southeast DC, I'm not going to have the same access, right? So a lot of this really leads to the Board of Education. So the Board of Education has to say, how much money are we going to allocate for things like, you know, updating our computer systems? How much money are we going to put in the system or allocate toward providing training for our teachers? Because at the end of the day, it's like the Board of Education can throw out, hey, here are curriculums that are provided by, you know, we no longer do lesson plans, right? Teachers used to do lesson plans and map everything out. Now it's all done like from an artificial intelligence perspective. Hey, this is at the fifth grade, this is where you should be. Sixth grade, this is where you should be, right? But at the end of the day, what we're not doing is putting the money into the technological footprint for these schools and training the teachers. It's almost like they're saying, okay, hey, AI is important, but it's not important for us to make sure that our instructors or our teachers have the resources that they need available to be able to say, hey, if these kids get to the 11th grade, 12th grade, the jobs are going to be obsolete. But the jobs won't be obsolete because what we're doing is we're being proactive versus reactive. I think in America, we're so reactive versus proactive. And that is probably the underlying and the emphasis that we really need to place on the educational footprint, the technological footprint, and the training for the teachers in order to make this really a productive society. So therefore, when you're looking at, hey, our kids are now graduating 11th, they're preparing to graduate 11th, 12th grade, that they're already trained enough, the kids have enough knowledge and wherewithal from an information technology perspective that they can also be productive and be able to challenge whatever those jobs are to be able to be productive.
It's something that Zia was, go ahead.
No, you're good. I think Brandon was going.
Oh, sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt, but something that Zia was talking about with like how there's like a difference between like professor to professor for how the AI approach is because it's so new. And that's going to be like, I think the same challenge is happening in like the higher ed space is happening, is definitely present in the K-12 space. Like certainly in my high school, right? You have like two things kind of happening simultaneously. On the one hand, you have teachers that are saying, and rightfully so, they're like, these kids are using AI to cheat, right? And at the same time, we're like, also, we probably ought to give them exposure to this thing because all these jobs are going to require it. This is a challenge, and this is kind of like our challenge for the discussion. So like, that's kind of how I think of that framework. I'm sure it looks a little more nuanced in the, you know, the post-secondary space, but the teacher education piece that Ms. Knight was talking about is going to be huge in terms of like teaching teachers to use AI. Like if a teacher has never used AI to write like personal correspondence or to write a lesson plan or to do any of those things, they're going to be much slower to adopt it in their classroom. And also kind of like shifting how we think about different tasks. I'm sure we'll get into this when we talk more about like standard specific stuff, but like we kind of have to go in knowing like these are the two ideas that seem contrary to each other, but having those conversations about like, okay, what is appropriate use for AI? Because again, we took our IT kids to Microsoft the other day, and the conversation, we were talking about this offline briefly, the conversation was about how those jobs are already shifting. The expectation at Microsoft was everyone knows how to use AI. Everyone uses AI to write their personal correspondence. They don't write code from scratch. They are reviewing emails that the AI has written. They are reviewing code that the AI has written. And that's a shift that we need to acknowledge. Otherwise, we're not preparing our students for those jobs that are just 2 years away for some of these students, or a year away. So it needs to be in our curriculum. We need to, like, we have a responsibility to give them exposure to it and talk about like what not only ethical use is, but just like what productive use of those AI models are, and really address like those teachers that really think it is just cheating, like have a point of view. We need to have those conversations about like what is happening and how, you know, school leaders see its appropriate use and what those standards should look like.
Yeah.
Well, so Lita, kind of piggyback off that as well, to your point, it's like you want the child to have a technological footprint, right? And to understand what the technology is about. But then you also saying, hey, but I need you to go research this, go Google this, right? Which is all AI, right? If you're using any of those tools, you Google that, you bring the information back. And I think Hassan said, you know, you got to have the thought process. You go out there, you do the research, and then you come back and you do your own mission statement based on what your research was, versus just saying, hey, I went out there, found this article on questions for the roundtable, and then I published the questions verbatim. Then, of course, that's plagiarism. But how do, again, the bigger question, how do we educate the students and the teachers to say it's okay to use, you know, AI and whatever, because we use it every day anyway. So that's the reality. It's like we use it every day, but then we also say in certain instances, don't use it, or there's a balance between what you use and what you don't use.
I want to jump in, and then actually, Zia, I know you were going to share something too. I wanted just to jump in for two parts. One earlier, Valerie, you had mentioned something about, you know, the funding and things of that nature. Just to, you know, make sure I throw this in there, that's the council and the mayor's charge. And so they are responsible for that. And that's certainly things that, you know, we can advocate for. But I just wanted to make sure I threw that out there as well. Zia.
And Brandon, I want to piggyback real quick. We understand that therein lies the problem, right? Because we're also saying that is at the local government level. And at the local government level, you might, like DC has Okta, right? But does the Board of Education specifically have its own technology team that they're sitting between the Microsofts and the IBMs or whomever they are, or Dell, saying, hey, this is just for the Board of Education, and you work in conjunction with Okta? Because if you think about the local government, they're 20 years behind. Let's be real about where they are from a technological standpoint. But the children and the kids that really suffer as a result of that, they are sitting in the middle of the political side of it, as well as the technological side of it. And then we end up with, to everybody's point, like now we're in this mess, in this quandary of who the responsibility lies on, but it also affects that this fundamental conversation that we have right now to say, okay, it's a government issue. We know that. But how do we say, okay, you know, it's important that the children now are educated, because for most grown folks, by the time these kids get out 11th, 12th grade, they're no longer here in the first place. So that's the bigger question I think I want to pose to, how do we get around it? How do we circumvent saying, okay, hey, it's a local government issue, but how does that funding get down to the educational level where a representative Betts and Patterson can say, hey, you know what? We have the funding now to have these STEM labs in our schools. And this is, you know, we have this money for not just 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, that every year, because technology is forever revolving.
Yeah, this is such fascinating conversation. I wanted to jump in and just say something that I noticed right before the pandemic. I wrote a book about education and technology that I put out in January of 2020, which is a terrible time to release a book, just for anyone who's wondering. The thing that I noticed when I was in schools as a Microsoft consultant, I was going to all sorts of schools, is the assumption that Gen Z and now Gen Alpha, the coronials we'll call them, my kids' generation, that they're really inherently good at technology. Like they just know how to use technology really well. And I think it's a misnomer. This is really important to understand, because the kids of the 80s, I started using computers in 1988. So all I had was a DOS command line. And I had to figure out how to talk to a computer in a way that there weren't any apps that really supported me. I had Lotus 1-2-3, but I was like 4, so I didn't know how to use it. I didn't know what it was for. I had my games. What I learned over the years, and as Windows progressed, and then eventually using Mac OS and iPhone and all that, is that I learned how to talk to computers and debug things. I learned how to understand how to think in algorithms, because if I had a problem to solve, I had very few tools to actually solve the problem with. I had to learn to write a computer program. I had to learn to write Excel to solve the problems that I had with computers. What our students have now are a collection of apps. So if they have a problem to solve, then they will ask you, well, where's the app to solve it? Give them a problem to solve without an app. Some of them will be able to. I'm not saying it's all the case, but most of them will say, where's the app, right? How do you make an app? How do you talk to a computer? And now it feels like with ChatGPT, specifically with ChatGPT, I can now talk to a computer and a computer can talk back in my language. It is the most eerie thing in the entire world to have a conversation with a piece of technology that for my whole life I've had to speak to in computer code and now can speak my language. It's like it just woke up. Computational thinking goes completely outside of technology itself. It may sound like it's technology, but it's how we approach problems, how we think about things, how we think about pattern recognition, and how we teach pattern recognition. We do this in our math lessons. I've taught in DC. I know that we teach this sort of thing. We rarely connect it to the problems that our students actually have. So think about it from a teacher's perspective. You have a class of students, and perhaps you want to figure out how to provide equitable groups for these students. You can then say a list of students, and you can protect their privacy using initials and whatever it might be, right? With reading groups and math levels, maybe a social emotional strength, maybe a social and emotional weakness, or something that they, in the classroom that you've noticed, they don't do so well. And ChatGPT can leverage that text and tell you, here are groupings that you can make where this student, and give you the rationale, where this student can now teach this student how to do the thing that they don't know how to do. Right? I can do this as a teacher, but the amount of time that it would take me to do that on top of my already busy schedule is quite staggering. So it plays a role both for students to be able to solve their own problems and not just to say, hey, how'd you use it, friend? I'm going to use it to write this paper. But how do I actually go beyond that and solve the problems in my life that are relevant to me? And that requires many, many examples of how it's being used. And then for teachers, it requires them to think outside of just lesson planning and assessment and rubrics. Those things are really important to be able to speed through and write a lesson plan quickly using AI. But what I've tried to do is say, how do you embed class observations, notes about your class, qualitative data, and have it leverage that text and tell you some patterns that it's noticing that you may not notice? And I've done this before. I've had it generate dummy data so that, like, a lot of dummy data so I can see. You can keep an embedding, which is just a chat, going for a long period of time and seeing these connections over time start to form. You can create groupings and connect students in ways that they've never been connected before, and maybe you wouldn't have the opportunity to. All teachers have the qualification to be able to do this, but they don't have the time. So I'll pause there.
I personally love that. You know, you just shared a lot about the how we're teaching and how that's going to be changed. And earlier I mentioned that experts believe that tech will not only change how we teach, but what we teach as well. So I want to ask you, you know, Zia, like, as we start to think about what we teach, what should be changed in that category as we think about all this emerging technologies that we're starting to see?
I'm so glad you asked, Brandon, because I had a conversation with ChatGPT about this very thing. You know what it was? Bloom's taxonomy. A lot of us are familiar with Bloom's taxonomy. There's a taxonomy of skills or of thinking, cognition skills, creating being at the top of that list, and then remembering being at the bottom of this sort of pyramid that we often see Bloom's represented as. And when Google could answer any question, we would, you know, we'd Google could answer any question. We could look up a piece of information. It made remembering kind of useless at this point to teach, at least as a skill. Now, ChatGPT can do all of these things. It can evaluate. It can create new things. So, what do we teach students? This is what I asked ChatGPT, and what it gave me was a list of things that I found to be extremely human-centric activities. Things like collaboration. For instance, if you are working with your partner on an experiment and you ask them, how are you doing? And they say, I'm fine. And you can sense in their voice that they aren't actually fine. Guess what? You're leaning into being human, right? Teaching students to identify and do things like self-awareness of their own emotions, right? How do I feel about what's happening right now? And then what's the responsible decision that I need to make about that? A computer cannot have core values. AI cannot have core values. It can't. It's not internal. You can maybe program it to have the illusion of having core values. So what do we teach students? We make a list. I mean, the list can go on and on, but it is, to me, and still the core subjects are still important. We have to get the foundations. I'm not trying to downplay and minimize that. But I think on top of that, we need to up our game when it comes to social and emotional learning. When a child falls off a bike, they get a ton of input, a lot of data, sensory data that encourages them to learn. Right? A computer only has one way of receiving data, whether it's coming through a microphone or a sensor or whatever. It's all being converted to zeros and ones. But we humans have this emotional connection. And we do a little bit of that, right? We have like maybe once a week, there's a social and emotional class or an hour of something. It needs to be embedded into the culture. And I know DC and DCPS is actively trying to do that. But we need to step up our game even more. We need to have students having conversations with each other in ways that allow them to probe each other and really bring out emotion within each other, understand what makes these topics important to them. And things like collaboration, things like coaching, honestly, coaching skills is really important. I think that should be taught in all schools to all students. And understanding, when I think of critical thought, not just understanding, you know, how to think about something from multiple sides. GPT can help you do that, but understanding what's important to that person. What are their core values? I didn't know my core values until age 36, right? Which for me was 2 years ago, right? I never had the opportunity to understand what types of thoughts I have that sabotage me when I'm out in the world. And I know this sounds like it's not related to AI, but these are the things that keep me up at night. These are the things that I think about, because now that AI can do a lot of the thing, like it can write a 5-paragraph essay on Romeo and Juliet. Are you kidding me? Can eat that for breakfast. So we have to now ask students, what's actually in your heart? What direction do you want to go? Because now you get to decide and you get to take the reins and you get to use AI as a companion to help you get there.
That was much deeper approach than I had anticipated when I read that question. No, it's great. It really is good.
And I know that I was right there with you, buddy.
No, it's great. And like, you know, I've been in the K-12 space for, gosh, I'm too long, but like almost 15 years. And like the work we do in DCPS with SEL is ongoing and it permeates everything that we do. We're not done. I love the idea that like AI is going to allow us maybe to focus more on it. We had our Rambler reflection today where we had meditative spaces and are doing our best to try to explore those areas with students. I took the question to mean a more practical one because you mentioned something earlier, which is like that the computer can now talk to you now. And I'm not wanting to push back on that, but I do want to remind us it's a natural language model. Not all of our students have mastered language as a communication skill. In fact, many of them are challenged in doing so. So where we see some students that, yes, now I can talk to the computer and AI offers me a way to like circumvent learning coding, right? Because now I can talk to it. If you haven't mastered the ability to communicate or the English language, you actually can't talk to that computer. So in terms of practical skills, and not to say that like what you were talking about with SEL is impractical, it is hugely important. But on a practical level, I need to teach my students how to actually talk to the computer using those language skills. And that does mean it's not just prompt writing, but it's using language to talk to the computer. And that is really like through trial and error and through seeing how like the nuances of how language works. And like, again, we did a fun one in my IB theory of knowledge class where they had an assignment where they had to use an AI art generator and combine it from something from their IB math class. And then, from their IB art portfolio. And then we turned that into an NFT and asked the giant question, what did we make? Like, is this even art anymore? But the process I found the most interesting was watching them fumble around with the AI art generator because they're like, it's not giving me the results I wanted. And then, but it is for Jamie. Why is that? And we looked at the prompts and we had like a big discussion about like Jamie was more specific with what she was able to more clearly articulate what she wanted the AI art generator to do. So she was solving the problem better because she was a better communicator. And my students seeing that firsthand was like this mind-blowing thing. Like she's better at coding or talking to the computer because of her ability to communicate. So a lot of this for our students means practice with prompt writing, seeing like good and bad examples in a bunch of different content areas, because that's going to look different in math as it's going to be in like my history class. Like my World History 2 class has an assignment coming up where we're going to use language models to, for the first time, work with us in our Holocaust essay. Because I had a student last year, similar to Zia, your example, I had a first student submit their Holocaust essay and it was all ChatGPT and it actually made up two sources from Knight. I've read that book so many times because I've been teaching that course for so long, but I was like, I don't remember these quotes. It's because they don't exist. So, the model is like, yeah, this quote would be amazing for this essay were it in the book, but it wasn't. So these are the kind of ways that we need to like teach responsible. Like this is a tangible skill. It's like communicating. They need practice. They need to see like what it can and can't do. And that kind of gets us into the ethics of like how you have to review the stuff, how the work shifts. And like, if you are going to use an AI language model to do this work, your job is not done. It's not like now I can go play Fortnite. Now it's like, I have to sit and review what it did, see if it's in my voice. Is this responsible at this point? And, you know, that's going to be like our real challenge in terms of like to the boots on the ground folks. Like we have to figure out what that looks like practically, especially for people who aren't like doing trial and error all the time. So yes, I took that to mean something different, but I think they just need a lot of practice and yeah.
But I want to, so Hassan spoke also about the emotional inability to have emotions, right? So that I think that's a big component when you talk about AI. AI is an emotionless tool because what you put in it, a lot of it is calculated and transferred and translated back out. So Lee, I wanted to ask you from the model that you're using to instruct your kids, like from your counterparts, some of the same folks that you, your coworkers, how many people are using the same business model, if you will, or technological footprint in order to instruct their students as well? Lee,
I think you're muted.
Sorry. The question was like, how many of my colleagues are using AI language models?
Yeah.
Not many. I've had this conversation with my, like, we're kind of in this weird space where a handful of my colleagues that really do like to push the envelope are trying different things or are connected. Like I found from a colleague that like Auburn University is doing like a training for their professors on like teaching responsibly with AI. We're finding like bits of things across the internet. Like I'm sure I'm going to pick Zia's brain when we're done about like, hey, send me some stuff. Because again, we're trying to figure this out. Not a lot of people, there's definitely no rules on it, which is why we're talking, right? Like there's no guidance from DCPS. Obviously we haven't written it. This is Aussie. Like I contacted IB because I was like, what do I do if we have a student doing their extended essay and too much of it is like using an AI model, or what if they use Grammarly too much, which is kind of doing the same thing because they lose their voice. And like how much is too much Grammarly, which is like, I don't know the answer to these questions. There are some definite ethical issues here. I don't know the answers to those, but I do think that we can, in this panel and with Aussie, set some standards where we at least make it so that every teacher has access to some training so they can try it. And then we don't force, but we sort of like integrate it with our existing curriculum to make sure there are some like safe, responsible ways to expose kids to this so that we're all kind of growing together. Because if we don't do anything, we're going to end up in this space sort of like we were with smartphones, where it just kind of caught us off guard that like every kid all of a sudden has a smartphone and a lot of schools didn't have like, you know, they didn't have an identity with how they wanted to, like, what do you want us to do with this thing? It has all the answers, and yet I don't know the rules around it, but it can make me better, but it's also cheating. And so like we're in this unique time where like we can think about and be intentional with like, all right, we want teachers to at least do this kind of exposure so that the kids have this kind of practical use. We all know what it is. And then we'll kind of tweak as we go. I don't want to do the thing where we're like, let's just wait and see. Let's wait 2 years and see where this takes us and it'll all shake out. I think that's a huge mistake. So my one contribution to this panel is like, I'd rather try something and sit and say, look, how do we across the board figure out a safe way to get some exposure for some practical uses of AI that might give them a shot to use this so that when they get to either their job or college, it's not their first time using it with no guardrails. Yeah. Right. And they're just like on Reddit trying to figure out like, how do I do this without getting kicked out of school? Like that shouldn't be the first time they're thinking about it. And we can do that. And if we get it wrong a little bit, we tweak and we try something else. But that's what I think we can have a takeaway and we could get those in place. I don't think it should take forever. I think we can do that responsibly, especially with the experts on this panel and some others that are out there in the space.
Question to Representative Betts and Patterson, are from a school board perspective, are they looking at a baseline to say, okay, let's introduce artificial intelligence in each one of, like, it has to be a part of curriculum. Even if it's a 50-50 split, because you still have to have the human interaction, but also the introduction to AI, I think will give most students a leg up, and then they won't feel so lost when they're now coming up to, hey, I got to take my SAT, my ACT, and now, oh, by the way, I got to get ready for college. But hey, there's a whole computer science piece of these exams that I haven't even been introduced to. So from that perspective, to Representative Betts and Patterson, is there a benchmark? Are they looking at like a baseline to say, hey, we need to come in now, revamp the technological footprint that we have today, train our teachers and get us ready for what is to come? Because most people are saying to come, even though it's already here. So what work is being done to say, hey, this is the path forward and this is some of the steps that we need to take?
So what you're seeing is the beginning of that. You know, we are looking towards that, and we're trying to figure out or determine what is the best step, whether it's training, whether it's standards. You know, we know that something has to be done, and we're trying to make sure that what we do is the right thing. And so part of the reason that we're having this conversation is so that we can all learn from you and as we start to think about like what is next. So I'm glad that you Mr. Lee James, that you talked about standards and academic standards. I've always believed that if there's anything that's worth teaching, it's worth having standards on. But we have to make sure that we do it right. And one of the things that I know is that AI is changing fast, right? And so like, how can academic standards remain flexible and adaptive to the rapidly evolving nature of AI and technology?
I think that's an explosive question though. And yeah, as y'all all said, yeah, it's an explosive question because it's like, we're behind. You know, if we think about artificial intelligence, we think about other countries, and Hassan, I don't know where you're from, but I like the fact that you said at 4 years old, you were playing around with DOS. Like, you think about children today. I can tell you 99.9% of the children that have touched a PC have no clue what DOS even is, right? So if you talk about now, kids are now learning Excel, then you got to use, you got Power BI, which is really like DOS on steroids. When you got to look at technology from a technological footprint, that we're forgetting that we are already behind. Like, we got to play catch up. And is it going to be something that's graceful? Absolutely not. It won't be a graceful approach because in a minute, the kids are going to be running the classes because to Lee's point and to Hassan's point, the kids now are out doing searches in Google and using the chats and everything else where the instructors are not. They're not technologically savvy enough to understand where the technology is going. So I think the broader question is, how fast does the Board of Education want to move? And then how swift are they going to get the necessary technology in place for and instructors? Because not just the technology is one piece of it. And your qualified and certified instructors to be able to give the direction that needs to be given in order to make this seem like you're catching up, but really you're not really catching up. You gotta you really gotta kind of jump in head first. It's almost saying, hey, I'm going to take, I know I gotta take my ASVAB test, right? I should have studied 10 years ago because I knew it was coming because I'm now almost a senior. So now you're at the front door. Now you're like, oh, now I need to study. No, the preparation starts today. Like even from the Board of Education, you can no longer say we're behind. You have to say, okay, today we're having a conversation. Out of this conversation, there should also be breakout sessions to say, okay, now what do we do next? Because we can have this conversation. You can get this great panel together. You get people like, you know, Hassan, James, myself, Wolf. We all can be on here. We can have an amazing conversation. But then James goes back to the classroom and Hassan goes back to college and says, hey, we had a great conversation, but there were no implementation. There's no implementable task that came out of that. But then what is next? So we had these conversations and we say, hey, both representatives, okay, what do you guys need from us to be able to say, hey, let's push the envelope to not say that we're behind, but how do we get ahead of where we already are? In order to make this cohesive, it's not going to be pretty, no matter who. You know, I can't make it pretty. James can't make it pretty. Hassan can't make it pretty. So how do we get to the next steps to say, let's move and how swift we're going to move to make AI be a part of the curriculum, but also make sure that we have the tools in place from the Board of Education, from the state and local level, and from the White House down to all your congressional folks to say, we got to do something a little different.
Brandon, so, can you repeat that question one more time? I missed.
Yeah,
that.
Yeah. I say one of the things that I realized is that AI is changing fast, right? So we're saying that we Mr. Lee James had brought up the academic standards, which is something that we are definitely looking at right now. But how can academic standards, if we're thinking about academic standards and AI is changing so fast, how can the academic standards remain flexible and adaptive to this rapidly evolving nature of AI and technology? So once again, you know, like if we're saying we want to make sure that all of our teachers have a baseline of what they can teach as it relates to artificial intelligence, how do we ensure that, you know, 2 months later, that what we are sharing isn't already old news.
Because right, but that baseline is.
I'm sorry, Val. I just want to make sure Zia gets an opportunity to respond to it.
Oh, yeah, go ahead.
Sure. Yeah. So It I understand the concern that it's like, well, if we have trained teachers to do certain things, then next week they're going to release some new model that changes everything. What I have noticed, though, is that the progression of the different models that have been released build on one another in a way that just allows more flexibility and more power. Now, that may change. There may be more models in the future. But ultimately, when my child walks into my, I have a toddler. When my toddler walks into a room, he points at a ball and says ball. He points at a cup and he says cup. He points at the door and he says bye. Now, why does he say bye? He says bye because he's doing pattern recognition. And one day we'll laugh about it and he'll say, oh, shut up, dad. But we'll laugh about it and say, okay, you thought door was called a bye, but he's making that connection because people say bye when they walk through the door. And essentially, that's what ChatGPT is doing. And even the models that come after it are going to be faster and more accurate. But he's going to grow out of that. ChatGPT, at least in its current form, will not. It'll get more powerful. And it's an amazing magic trick. So to answer the question about the standards, what do we do about how do we make sure that we're not going to get outdated? The academic standards as they currently stand in the Common Core, to me, are not going to necessarily need to change. But there is one thing that I will draw your attention to, and that is this. When I had my students in my college class first have their first coaching conversation, I taught them how to coach one another. One was the coach, one was the coachee. And this was to develop ideas for what would have been an essay in the past. The ideas that they come up with in this conversation then could go into ChatGPT to be organized further, right? That was the thing I considered like almost like it could be cheating, but I don't consider it cheating. Okay, so after the conversation, I asked my students, these future teachers, what was that like for you to have this conversation? And the first person raised their hand, like just, you know, out of their seat, and they said, I get it. They said, the future of education is not about getting the right answer. It's about asking the right questions. And this plays so well to what Lee said earlier. It's about asking the right questions. And we have standards that say ask and answer questions. But I have noticed that when we teach them and when we have curriculum around them, we're really focused on the answer part and not so much the ask part. And that is the fundamental shift, because not only do we need to learn how to ask each other questions, but we need to learn how to ask computers questions, to be specific to Lee's point earlier about his student and the art piece. So I don't think that teaching that it's like all of a sudden we're going to have some brand new thing in the future. If you understand, like I understand how to use ChatGPT 4, when I got the ability to send pictures to it, now it's like I actually asked it, like, does this outfit go? Right. But I knew how to do that because I knew what could be capable. Right. There are people that hear that and they're like, oh, I never thought of doing something like that. But that's because I knew how to use it from before. So when teachers understand the basic concepts and new models get released, they will adapt relatively quickly from what I have seen so far in the progression. And in terms of the academic standards, there's no real need to change anything, in my opinion, but we need to focus on how are we going to leverage text? For instance, if you have a standard on identifying perspectives in a text, well, ChatGPT could eat that for breakfast. You could put in a piece of text, ask it to analyze the perspectives, it'll pull it out. How do we teach students to have conversations, face-to-face, in-person conversations about different perspectives, and then use GPT as a tool to perhaps organize their thinking, leverage the text? Someone in the chat asked about concerns about bias, and that's a really, really good concern, really good question. And what I think about that is, I don't think of these AIs as some super Google research machine, even though you could use them that way. I think of them as, how am I going to take text that would have taken me a while to analyze before and use it to speed up the process? How can I treat it like my intern rather than my guru? So I hope that starts to answer the question.
I love that. And so I start to think about those basic concepts. So you talk about pattern recognition, and you talked about prompt, or like asking the right questions. And so I wanted to, you know, just like kind of like backwards, take a step backwards and talk about like prompt engineering. Would that be like prompt engineering? I know, Mr. Lee James, you had mentioned it's not prompt engineering. It's like, how do you use the language? And so I just want to go back to that just to make sure we are thinking about the right things.
I haven't had as much experience as Zia has had with it. I obviously am not like beta testing, you know, a Model 4 or anything like that. But I mean, you're right. It's like how to using natural language, how to be able to communicate like to problem solve, to get the desired solution. And that takes a lot of trial and error, even for someone that's like pretty, you know, fluent or like even good with computers. Like none of that matters. It's just a matter of practice and being able to communicate like your ideas and seeing like what works and being able to talk to the computer. So like in terms of practical application, it's going to be like kids in the prompt figuring out what's going to be best, which kind of goes to like one of Zia's earlier points, because we're talking about standards and like, do we have to adjust the standards? I don't know that we need to adjust the standards. If we were going to add anything to a across the board standards, it might be something like a healthy technology, like a tech standard that might apply across the board about like, we want to make sure that there's a touch point in all these places, and then Asi maybe giving examples of what that looks like, because it's going to look different. Like I talked to a pre-calc student today. I'm like, how do you use it? It was in anticipation of this conversation. And he was like, oh, it's not great right now at getting a lot of like calculus answers, but if you tell it the answer, it'll tell you how it got there. And I thought that was fascinating. I'm like, thanks, Roman. He's amazing. And he also was like, see, gave me an example. And so he's using it. And we could teach math teachers to be like, look, it's going to show you step by step how to solve these particular answers in like your pre-calc or calc class. That's going to look very...
Haley, I'm so sorry. I'm dropping off in a minute. So I want to just get in one and I will turn it back to you. I apologize. Thank you all for having me. I'm just going to say that real quick before I drop off. My students are going to be like, oh, you're late. You always say don't be late, but it's okay. So just to hit on that prompt engineering part of asking the right questions, of figuring out what the right question is, I'm just going to echo Lee here, is about trial and error. It's about saying, there is an answer that I seek to find. What is the question that I need to ask? A lot of times as educators, we sometimes do that asking for them. We help them through that. Now we need to give the reins to them. We need to let them be independent thinkers and say, what is the question? What is my research question? What am I curious about? And what is it that I want to learn? And see what AI can give them. Now we can help them shape those questions a little bit and really stay in those questions without saying like, what's the answer? Okay, one last thing and then I'm gonna drop off. A puzzle and a game, okay? A puzzle gets more simple as you move through it. And a game gets more complex as you move through it. It starts off simple, it gets more complex. A puzzle starts off more complex, it gets more simple. We have treated education like a puzzle for so long. And it's starting to become a game under that definition. So I'll leave you with that thought. It's 7 o'clock and I have to run to my class. It was wonderful meeting all of you. And I hope to hear more about this conversation later. Okay, bye.
I don't know if it's the sweater, but he just sounds so much more sage and like, you know, than like every, mine's just like off the cuff. Like, all right, let me tell you what it looks like in my classroom. But I know.
Like he's very zen with it, right?
Yeah, exactly. I'm like, all right, well, I need to pre-write this down because it's not going to be articulate or have an idiom attached to it. No, it's wonderful.
You got to go back and see the chat.
One I love listening to him.
Talk about too. I know, Brandon, you asked, you know, how do you, like, what is the follow-up and follow-through? As like you get all this stuff in place, right? You come up with the curriculum for the teachers are following this curriculum. What is, you know, how do you follow up and follow through? You have to create a task force. Like if this is what the direction that you guys want to go in, you have to have a task force, because you can't say, it's just like, you know, like Lee was saying, like when you're in school, you have a curriculum, right? This is your curriculum. You know that you got a touch point with your professor every 6 weeks, 7 weeks or whatever. You would have to create a task force for, you know, at the Board of Education level, that is their job. For every school that is in the District of Columbia that is following these standards, that task force, they are doing 365. They have to go to these different schools and they're doing check and balances when the next one rolls out, because it's like you got iterations, right? So just in technology, you have to do the same thing with education to say, okay, and this, look, we got four quarters in the game. For this quarter, this is what we're doing for this 3 months. And as you go through the school year, you got, somebody has to be accountable. So it's accountability that actually is going to drive the new direction of technology and the direction that you want to go in from an educational perspective.
I absolutely love I absolutely love that.
Now I'll head the task force, but I'm I'll head the task force. But yeah, you have to have a and you can even call it, you know, a technological AI task force or whatever you want to call it, but it has to be something that the somebody says snaps. It has to be something that really says, okay, not only are we going to implement this new footprint, but we also are going to follow up and follow through. So don't think just because you decide to be a teacher, you got to come in here because you want to get your student loans paid for and you're not really going to do the work. In order to be here and be a part of this establishment, you not only do you have to follow this new baseline, so you have the baseline and your curriculum is a 50-50 split, whether it's from a technological standpoint or the old school traditional, let's create a lesson plan. But now, the Board of Education's responsibility is to say, hey, now that we have all this in place, this task force, your job, and most of those folks are going to be tech folks, your job is to follow up and follow through, do reporting, and to get back and then do an annual report or however you need to do it to say, okay, these are the standards that we're following. There's some work. There's always going to be a wiggle room for some work that needs to be done on the back end, because there's still going to be some training, some additional things that have to be done with that task force to make sure that the board understands, make sure that the teachers understand, therefore the students will understand the direction that the school is going in.
So I just want to say thank you for that. It is now about seven. It's 3 minutes past seven. I want to pass the mic back to Mr. Lee James. I believe you were responding. And then I would like to go to the Q&A that's in our chat, and then hope to get you all out here by responsible time, respectable time.
I will keep this quick. So the two things I was saying, it actually connects to what Zia's like parting sage wisdom was about, which is part of like, I don't know that we need to like change the standards for fear of like outrunning the AI, but we do need to, part of the teacher training that will have to go into effect if you want this to be real, as Ms. Knight has pointed out a bunch of times, which is 100% correct. All this is for naught if you don't actually follow up with it and get very like clear instruction, but like you have to change assessment for like NDC. And what that means is like you can't go with existing curriculum that was written pre-AI and just assume that and not take it into accountability. You kind of have to operate where, all right, I'm going to give, like practically, I have to give tests now where I'm going to assume this part is no technology and I'm assessing it for this one thing in mind to see if they like master these content standards using the resources I put in front of them. And then this one might be a writing standard and I'm going to assume that every kid has access to AI. And it's on me to go, all right, what does that look like if every kid was using AI and evaluate it based on that standard? Now, whether they do or not is whatever, but you kind of have to go at it with that approach. You can't just like throw the same test you've been doing and assume a kid with a device or with a phone is not going to use it. And so you have to kind of think about how you're going to assess and for what purpose. And you can adapt old curriculum to do this, right? You could still figure out, say like no tech for this part, this part's writing, here's responsible tech use. Show me your prompts if you did use an AI generated response, right? What was the prompts that you used? You have to submit those with it. Like things like that. There's ways to do this responsibly. And there's other people that have written on this topic that are steps ahead of me that we should look to be like, how can we do this? And then put that to teachers to be like, take your existing curriculum and kind of like, here's how we navigate this space. Can be done, but we have to be really proactive. More not because I'm afraid the technology is going to adapt too fast. I'm afraid that the adoption rate by kids and what their habits will be around it will get solidified. Right. And like we become our habits. And so all our kids will just be using this with no guardrails if we don't act quickly.
Thank you for those final points. Mickey, did you just take yourself off mute?
Yeah, I was just going to respond. I apologize. I feel like I was an attendee in the conversation for the last 25 minutes, hearing so many great points shared by Val, Zia, and Lee. But just wanted to kind of encapsulate a couple of the quick things that I was, thinking about and kind of how our work's done at Dent. So one, when it comes to, the standards and skills around AI, I think there's a good point made that there's a couple different buckets of bigger AI types of tools, the language generation or like text to idea generation. There's the image generation and
kind of video editing applications. I've seen a lot of cool stuff in the design space kind of used for that. And ways I would like two skills. You mentioned pattern recognition is one. I think quality control and also applying or leveraging a tool for a passion project are both some of the skills that I would think about when it comes to students being able to use these tools. At Dent, the program we're launching is called AI Academy, where students will use these artificial intelligence tools to be growing their own business. And I can imagine this is going to look like a lot of different things as we actually get into the program. But, you know, people are thinking about social media. Okay, social media is the area you want to focus on. Google, what are AI tools related to social media? And you might find video editing software or, you know, how to use ChatGPT to kind of write your own, you know, social media posts. I think that that sort of application is really important. And the other thing is quality control. You know, when, you know, Lee was telling a story about a student referencing like a quote from Knight that was not actually in the book. I had a similar experience where another teammate of mine had used ChatGPT to help with a grant application that we were writing. And like these quotes were so specific and they're referencing certain foundations or like this research said XYZ, but I couldn't find these quotes anywhere else online in the you know, kind of the internet. I was like, let me actually not submit that in this grant application and maybe find something else that speaks to our point. But I think that quality control piece is also, you know, a really, really important kind of aspect to this work.
Thank you for that. And, you know, I look forward to seeing more of what you all have with the AI work. You know, you guys do some amazing work over there at Dent. Hopefully we can get you all in DC. There was a question that I saw in the chat, the question and answer. And there was one that said, are there any concerns from the panelists over AI bias in relation to student learning? Are there any ways that AI bias will hinder or misguide student learning? Any known efforts to correct this?
I'll hand that one to me.
Oh, go for it. Go for it.
Hey, Leo, put that one in your lap.
Oh, I didn't. I mean, I'm happy to jump in. I thought, so it is a challenge because, as we know, like language, like the AI is not some autonomous thing. It's a collection of like language from the internet, which, as we know, is not a, is not without its bias. We talk a lot in my TOK class about how like algorithms are like people's, like it's just like a person that's, you know, their own biases are going to come out in the algorithms. And we've seen that a lot. So the same way that Mickey was kind of talking about quality control, a lot of the times when we're doing those pieces and asking it to do analysis for perspectives, we can do our own quality control to like using, I don't know, it's like old school internet, we can use to find out like, what are the perspectives in this area to make sure that we have this balance that we didn't somehow through our own prompt, maybe the question we asked led us to some weird corner of the internet, or it allowed for, you know, to be misinterpreted. And so that's going to take like a lot of practice or just teaching students to be like, all right, if you're looking in this area, here's like the role of experts in research is like a huge, thing we talk about in you know, the K-12 space, especially in high school. So the balance of that is like teaching kids what proper research looks like. And so that again comes back to quality control. If we ask it to do a thing, we have to check to see if it did an okay job, the same way we asked it to write a letter. Like, does this sound like me? Did it do the thing I wanted it to do? It's not like a perfect answer because obviously students, like, there's going to be some challenges with asking it, you know, from a language model that's just pulling from the internet. But best we can do is the best any of us can do, which is look to experts, try to, you know, look for quality control and balance it out the same way you would with, if we as adults were doing a research project, right?
I'll kind of share on the bias piece that I haven't seen as many applications to this when it comes to student learning, but I have seen it in terms of the bias that just the AI industry as a whole is having, as well as kind of where things are focused with the inputs into language models. My roommate is actually a PhD student studying ethical and trustworthy AI. And one of the things that she shared in this kind of presentation that she gave, which also I'm happy to connect you, Brandon, to her and other folks in the space, is that certain language of like African-American English will get flagged as, you know, it might be kind of normal vernacular for a group of young people speaking to one another. Some of that language can get flagged as hate speech in AI tools that, you know, similar language otherwise would not. And I'm sure that there's, you know, other kind of biases that, you know, exist within, you know, within AI. I think another one that just has really gotten highlighted with this OpenAI clash over leadership, and as probably most people on this call know, you know, that OpenAI, the board that was a nonprofit board kind of meant to be focused on AI safety, fired Sam Altman, the CEO. Then Sam Altman ends up getting reinstated a year later because all the investors and people that were, you know, more interested in the potential profits of AI, you know, kind of wanted to implement and, you know, kind of reinstate him in the role. I think that speaks to a really dangerous kind of trend in AI that, you know, a battle that's currently being fought around even the types of, you know, where the research is. Like this, my roommate's presentation, she talks about, here are kind of the top cited articles related to AI. And so many of them are related to efficiency and, you know, kind of maximizing productivity as opposed to topics like AI ethics or, you know, AI bias and governance. And so it just speaks to where I think a lot of the research is being, and a lot of big tech companies are the ones really driving a lot of these research papers, which is, you know, unlike kind of a lot of other ways that technologies might be developed from an academic perspective. So I think that those, you know, I'm not exactly sure how that will cascade into the student learning aspects of AI, but I do think that those are broader implications for the industry that could have a real impact in terms of how the technology is developed, how people think about it, things like that.
All right. I think Brandon has allowed me to take it away and kind of wrap us up. I can actually say I began this figuratively and literally in the dark, and this conversation has been so rich. I will readily admit I'm a novice. I'm a little scary about AI because I don't know very much, but this has been such a rich conversation. And one of the most pertinent points that I think we've gotten out of this is that, you know, there needs to be more done. I truly appreciate the answers to the questions, but I really appreciate Ms. Valerie Knight suggesting that we need a task force and looking into that. That's really something that we need to do as a state board, because we do have OSSI that's working on it. We have other individuals that are part of government that are working on this, but we also need to make sure that as the State Board of Education, we need to be in front of this, moving us from growing to actually being proficient. And AI is where we need to be. Instead of just growing, we need to get in there and just really work hard at it. And so I truly appreciate this conversation. I do want to let all the panelists know that during the course of this conversation, we also have had our Vice President, Fraser O'Leary, who joined us, and also our President, Ebony Rose Thompson, representatives from Wards 4 and Ward 7 that joined us throughout this conversation. So I want you guys to know that people have heard what what you guys have said this evening, and we're going to follow up on this because we want to make sure that we're taking actionable steps. I mean, with that, I'm going to conclude us for this evening. I want to say thank you for everyone who has joined us this evening for this conversation on artificial intelligence, and just look forward to just working harder in this area for all of us. And I don't know, Brandon, since it was your panel, you were such a great moderator, if there's anything else you want to say before, you know, we go offline.
No, I just want to say thank you again for your participation. And we're going to be taking in all of the things that you all said. And hopefully, like Jock said, we will come up with something and actually put some action to this. It's something that we really believe strongly in. We know that this is a technology that is here. It is present. As Valerie says, you know, we're behind as a nation. And so it's time for us to make sure that we start to make some actionable moves to ensure that all of our students, regardless of what city they live in, I mean, what area in the city they live in, that they would have access to this information that would hopefully put them in a place where they need to be when they graduate from high school and college.
Yep.
And so back to you, Jack. I think everyone will give you your time back. And we just want to say thank you all for being here. I know that this will be recorded, so others will be able to enjoy what you all shared. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you so much for this evening.